You know, as I share with you this morning, what a wonderful time to be alive. I mean, I couldn't pick. If I had the opportunity, I couldn't pick a better time to be alive. I couldn't pick a better time to live. Because the excitement, the expectation, the realization of God moving across our land, touching people's lives, healing rain coming down, setting the captives free, guys. You know, I shared with some people Friday evening, and they said, well, tell us about your mission trip. And so I started to share with them a little bit, and they said, man, surely you was afraid. Surely you was afraid to step out. And I said, if I was afraid, I'd have went home. Because you cannot be afraid when you're standing out on the mission field. You've got to believe that God is there. That you've got to believe that God is more than able. You've got to believe that God is greater than the enemy. And that we can drive the enemy back. We can set the captive free. Can I hear an amen out of that? And so this morning, I want to talk about the state of the church. And I want to challenge our church family. I want you to allow God's Spirit to so speak to your heart that you'll rise up and say, I want the rain to fall on me. I want the power of God's Holy Spirit to touch my life. I want the power of the Holy Spirit to give me victory over my difficulties and give me the ability to make a stand for the kingdom of God. Now, here's what I always remember. I heard this old preacher say this, and I thought, wow, this is really true. You know what? Probably this morning, some of us need to go by Calvary. You know why we need to go by Calvary? We need to get a little forgiveness. Amen. We need to go by there and say, God, forgive me of all the junk and forgive me all the silly things I've done and cleanse me and set me apart. But don't stop there. Go by Pentecost. We need a little power. Can I hear an amen out of that? We need to go by Pentecost and say, wow, God, I need the power of the Holy Ghost. Now think about this. It says, when the Holy Ghost comes up on you, you shall receive power to be a what? A witness. What'd you say? A witness. You shall receive power to be a witness. How many of you realize the church needs the power of the Holy Ghost that will stand up in the year 2015 and be a witness for Him? Amen? That will stand up and say, God, we're not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God to set the captive free. Amen? I'm not ashamed because it set me free, guys. Man, I looked and I listened and I thought, you know, here we are down in New Orleans. I'm 68 years old. Fred's 75 years old. Arthur Blessed, remember Arthur Blessed? Oh, Arthur Blessed's 77 years old. He came, carried the cross right down Bourbon Street. I missed him. I mean, here was old Arthur Blessed. He'd been all over the world carrying the cross, and yet at 77, Joe, he made it appear, marched right down through Bourbon Street carrying that cross, preaching the gospel and sharing the love of Jesus. How many of you realize God's not dead, amen? How many of you believe God's alive? How many of you believe He's alive today? Amen, He needs to be alive in our hearts, guys. And so I want you to think about the church of 2015. I believe the church, how many of you believe it ought to be a dynamic group of people full of the power and love of the Holy Ghost? Amen? That we ought to be a dynamic group of people that are so involved and so in love with God that we've got to tell somebody. We've got to share with somebody. We've got to take the message because the power of the Holy Ghost is upon me. And it makes me want to be a witness. Amen? Amen? You know, I thought about all of the old heads down there, Monty. I mean, here we are. And actually, it was kind of funny. They said, you're not an old head. You're 68. The rest of us all in our 70s. You know, but it was so fun seeing one man. Can you imagine this guy? One man, 87 years old, and he came this year. He was the oldest guy in our group, 87 years old. He's out there preaching on the streets, sharing the gospel, loving people, and, you know, one of the guys, that, as a matter of fact, has passed away. His name was Brother Kramer. I met Brother Kramer 41 years ago, and he was standing on Bourbon Street, and he had a black briefcase that had Jesus Saves on one side, and it had Jesus is Lord on the other side, and it was a portable an amplifier, and he was standing in the middle of Bourbon Street sharing the love of Jesus. Amen? Can you imagine that? And the last year that he went, he was in a wheelchair. And he, right before he went to the Lord, he called Fred and he said, Fred, man, I'd love to go. I want to go to one more time to Bourbon and I want to preach one more time. And Fred went all the way out to Nebraska, brought him all the way in a wheelchair, wheeled him down. I mean, here the guy couldn't walk. Wheeled him down, put him in Bourbon Street. Fred told the guy, he said, "You keep an eye on Brother Kramer. Don't let anybody get close to him." And Fred said, "I got involved, and I looked, and Brother Kramer's wheelchair was sitting there empty." And he thought, "Oh, wow, I've lost Brother Kramer." And he said, "I looked up, and he was walking and preaching right down Bourbon Street." Yeah, and that was his last big hurrah, and then he went with the Lord. But can you imagine? That's being a witness, wouldn't you say? And you say, this is what I want you to see about the church. I believe it's time that the church wakes up in the year 2015 and realize that we need to be the dynamic fellowship of believers, that we're united together in the power and love of God, that we have the Holy Ghost upon us, and we want to tell somebody about Jesus Christ. Can I hear an amen out of that? Now, here's the thing. I believe also the church ought to be biblically sound in everything we do. Can I hear an amen out of that? All that we do needs to be biblically based. All that we do and accomplish, we need to back it up with Scripture. It needs to be the foundation of what we're doing. And that's what I want to talk about as we talk about. And then, here's the thing, guys. The world is looking for something that's real. They're not looking for religion. They're looking for something that is real. And if we'll allow God in the year 2015 to rise up, fill us with the Holy Ghost, get us cleansed and set apart that we can be vessels that will bring glory and honor to Him, and that we're willing to step out for the kingdom of God, I want you to understand that's what the church the world is looking for. And it's time that we realize that. Now, here's an interesting thing. I think, number one, your focus. And I've been talking about this focus thing for a while. But how many of you believe your focus ought to be on Jesus Christ? Amen. Your foundation ought to be Jesus Christ. Paul says that I may know Him, Philippians 3:10, and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His suffering, that I may attain to this resurrection from the dead. Now think about this. Paul says my aim, my focus, Charlie, is that I know Him. You see, the aim of the church should be to know that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior of your life. That Jesus Christ is Lord of everything. And when you come to that decision and you surrender to Him, not make a commitment, but surrender to Him and say, "God, I surrender my life to You. I lay my life on the line for You. I lay my life on that altar, and I'm going to focus on You. I want You to be the Lord and Savior of my life. I want You to be the influence in my life. I want You to take my life and begin to mold it and shape it just like You." How many of you realize that's what the world's looking for? You see, it was kind of neat. Fred Bishop is my mentor. When I met Jesus Christ, I always laugh at him. I said, "Fred, I believe God's led me." I was going to say spoke to my heart, and I didn't know exactly what that meant back then. But God touched my life. I gave my heart to Christ. And I said, told Carolyn, I said, "I want to go to Oak Grove Baptist Church. I hear there's a guy, I don't even know his name, but he rides a motorcycle, and he's really turned on to the Lord." And I thought, and so here's the thing. I got to tell you this, and then I need to probably be more and more serious. Freddie hates me to tell this story. But Freddie was riding his motorcycle on the weekend for Sunday, and he had to go to the bathroom, and he was out in the woods, and he went to the bathroom and poison ivy. Oh, no. Can you get the picture? I get saved. I want to go see this guy that's riding a motorcycle. I want to find out about this guy that's all excited about Jesus. And guess where Freddie was? He was in the hospital. Wasn't even at church that Sunday. So Freddie says, "Gerald, you don't have to tell that story all the time." But Freddie took me under his wing, and he began to teach me the importance of making Jesus my focus. He taught me the importance of realizing that not only was He my Savior, but He was my Lord, and I had to submit to Him, that I had to surrender to Him, that I had to yield to Him and allow His power and love to mold and shape my life. Now, I want to tell you something, guys. In the year 2015, the reason we need to go by Calvary and the reason we need to get close to Calvary, there's a lot of sin in the camp, and there's a lot of junk in the camp. And the Bible says, don't let every weight and sin beat you so down that you can't run the race for Jesus. That's my paraphrase of Hebrews 12. And what happened? The church is not running the race. We are beaten down with sin. We're beaten down with problems. We're cast down, and we're a defeated look of a bunch of people. And God is saying, it's time to rise up. The falling rain is coming, guys. We need to be filled with the power of the Holy Ghost, but we need to get set apart, and we need to have that cleansing in our life. Can I hear an amen out of that? You know, here's the problem. The state of the church, and this is the state of the church, we're standing between two opinions. We've got so opinionated by the world, and we brought so much of the world in that they can't see a difference in our lives. Amen? And that's the trouble with the church today. We've adopted the ways of the world, and we've tried to incorporate the ways of the world, so we're standing on two opinions. But the other opinion is Jesus Christ is King of Kings. He's Lord of Lords. He's a God that's more than enough. He can change the circumstances. He can turn the difficulties into victory. Can I hear an amen out of that? You see, I believe that God wants to take the church. And here's one of the words. I want you to always catch this. I believe that God gave me this prophecy. And he says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. I knock at the door. And it's not to get in, but to get out, because the church has literally shut me down. The church has literally shut me down, and I want out because I want to work in power. I want to move in glory. I want to work through the people. And literally, we shut him down with all of our junk. So you need to go by Calvary. Does that make enough sense to you? And then, you see, you need to go by that Pentecost. You know, and this is kind of neat. You're getting a bunch of Baptists. And I've been Baptist all my life, okay? I mean, I always tell them, I said, I'm a better Baptist than most Baptists. I really am. At least I know what I believe as a Baptist. Okay, that's why I think I'm a better Baptist than most Baptists. Most Baptists, they're just Baptists. They don't know what they believe. They just believe I'm Baptist. That's enough of that. Okay? But you get around that and you start talking about the Holy Ghost, and they get a little nervous. Huh? And when I'm talking about the Holy Ghost, I'm talking about, he says, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, it gives you a power to be a witness in Ava. It gives you a power to be a witness in Jackson County. It gives you a power to be a witness in Perry County. It gives you power to be a witness in Illinois. It gives you power to be a witness around the world. And here's what the thing is that God is saying. The Great Commission is to go. That's the main word. Go into your neighborhoods. Go into your communities. Go under the anointing and the power of the Holy Ghost. He says, when you go, these signs will follow you. You'll lay hands on the sick and they'll do what? They'll recover. You'll preach the message of the gospel, and the gospel will set the people free. Amen? But how many realize we've lost our goal? If we've lost our goal, then we need to get a little Holy Ghost to push us out of there. Amen? Now, let me tell you a sad state of the church. We had five camps in New Orleans. Five different churches that we stayed at. These are big churches. I mean, when you try to house 200 people, it takes... And these churches are great big. But let me tell you the sad state of it. One of the churches that we stayed at, we had 50 men. And so they went to the Sunday morning worship. We outnumbered them by 10. We outnumbered them by 10. Every church that we went to and camped there, the reason we're getting in there to camp is because these great big churches have died. And they can't hardly pay the utility. And so they're glad that we come in. They're glad because we come in and we pay to stay there. We pay to use their facilities. And so they're willing. But isn't that a sad state of the church? They're sitting right down in the middle of Sin City. They're sitting there dying because they've closed the doors up and they've huddled together. And I always remember that. My granddaughter used to play basketball, and this one guy would always holler, break the huddle and play ball. Well, that's what the church needs. They need to break the huddle and start playing ball. Amen. Because you cannot huddle behind the walls and not go out and share the gospel and expect the church to grow. You've got to get out from behind the walls. You've got to go by and get a little power of the Holy Ghost and step out and say, wow, I want to do the will of the Lord in 2015. Can I hear an amen out of that, guys? Wow. And so here's the sad state of these churches. Can you imagine one church that their buildings, we could take everything we've got here and add two or three more churches and put it in part of their facility and still have room. That's how big these buildings are. They're big churches. 42 people in the one. 42 people. I mean, we're talking about gymnasiums. We're talking about dormitories. We're talking about educational classes. We're talking about these huge buildings with nobody in them. Isn't that sad? And so, you know, here's the thing, guys. It's time that we allow God to move in our life with freedom and with liberty. Now, I want you to take your Bible and go to Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2. And I want you to see this as I share this. Ephesians chapter 2. And I want to just read verse 10. You need to read kind of that whole chapter when you have time. But here's what it says. It says, for we are his workmanship, okay, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Now, I want you to notice the plural of that, for we, not just me, but we. We are God's workmanship. Let me give you a better translation. We are God's masterpiece. We are God's special design. And he's talking about the plurality of people coming together. He's talking about the church. That God has a masterpiece that he's designing. And it's bringing people together who are united together in Christ Jesus. Who are united together in the power of the Holy Spirit and the power of his love. And we become his masterpiece. Now, we fulfill that masterpiece when we realize we are his people, the sheep of his pasture, okay? And we fulfill that masterpiece when we allow God to cause a stirring within our hearts that we rise up and we begin to fulfill the purpose of God in our own lives. You see, God has got to speak to you individually. God has got to deal with you because salvation is only the starting place. That's the foundation. The Bible says there's no other foundation can a man lay except that which is laid in Christ. That's the starting place. But then he said, you build on this foundation, and he says, you have a choice. Matter of fact, it's 1 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter, if you want to put this down. And he says, you can build with wood, hay, and stubble. Okay? Or you can build with precious jewels and silver and gold. Okay? But he says, keep this in mind, that your works are going to be tried as by fire. Okay? Now, how would wood, hay, and stubble show up? Not very good. But here's the neat thing, just for one thought. You know what fire does to silver? It refines it and purifies it. Same to gold. Okay? And so he's saying to the church, my masterpiece, I've got a design. I've got a purpose for you. I've got a plan. And if you'll allow me, I will build in you and I will refine you and I will shape you and I will mold you to be like me. Amen? I'll make you a masterpiece. But here's the neat thing. Not just one piece, but I'll take all the pieces. And I'll blend all the pieces together, and they will represent me in my world, and you will be my masterpiece. You will be my master design. You will be my representative, because you will be like me. What, does that make sense to you? Huh? And that's what he's wanting to do to the church in 2015. He's wanting us to come together, united in power and love, allowing him to develop within us his purpose and his plan, but then to unite us together because, you know, one can put 1,000, but guess what? Two can put 10,000 to flight. That's pretty heavy, isn't it, huh? And so here's where we're at. The church needs to realize we are God's masterpiece. We are God's chosen people to represent him here on earth. And let me tell you what, guys. I know some people, you know, they're saying, well, one day he's going to come. He's going to rapture us out, and I'm going to get away from all this misery and all this suffering and all this, you know. But I'm going to tell you what. He's not coming for a defeated, discouraged church. He's coming for his bride that is adorned in his glory, ready for his appearing, and going to look for him. Amen? Amen? So it's time for a wake-up call for the church in the year 2015. God is wanting to take and stir the church and cause the church to come alive in him, causing the church to have the focus on Jesus Christ, that he is the Lord of it, having the focus that he has more power than we can even imagine to pour out upon us, and he wants to blend us together as his masterpiece. And you know what? Here's the thing about it is, how many of you realize love ought to have action? Yeah, shouldn't love have action? You know, I met Carolyn 50-some years ago. You know, I told her I loved her back then. I don't need to do it again. Huh? You think I'd get to C-51? Huh? I doubt if I'd get C-51. What do you think, bud? Huh? You know, I mean, you know, I want to tell her every day I love her. I want to tell her every day that she's the most beautiful woman in all the world. I want to tell her every day. I look at those black eyes, and oh, they just melt my heart. I'm telling you. So here I am. I'm God's masterpiece. I'm supposed to be in love with him. I'm supposed to be serving him. He's supposed to be my Lord. And yeah, I met him 50 years ago, and I'm all right. But I've not told him much I love him in worship. I've not told him I want to serve him. I'm not submitted to him. I'm not surrendered to him. I don't have prayer times with him. I don't want to pray. I got to do all these other things. Well, wonder why we're powerless, guys. You see what I'm saying? You've got to fall in love with him. And love has action. And action says, I'm going to tell him I love him. Love has action to say, I'm going to serve you. I'm going to go out and demonstrate that love. Amen? And so the church needs to have a wake-up call, and they need to realize that the church's focus is to represent him out in the world every day that we live, every day that we go about our life. We represent him. Now, I want you to think about this. It staggers my mind, okay? Do you realize that God looked down here at Kincaid Christian Fellowship? And he gave us the responsibility to represent him in Southern Illinois. I wouldn't have done it. Can you imagine that God has looked at his world, his creation, the very thing that he loved, the very thing that he sent his son to die on the cross for, to save and redeem, and then he gave the responsibility to the church to take the message. Pretty heavy, isn't it? And he's sitting waiting for us to wake up and share that message of love, to demonstrate it, the way we live, the way we do business, the way we go about our lives, that we tell people, not only in words, but in action, our lives have been changed. I'm no longer the same. I'm a new creation in Christ Jesus. Old things have passed away, and I'm new in Christ Jesus. Isn't that exciting, guys? Now, listen to I read this. Larry, if I could have had time, would have had this video. But there's a Colt commercial. And this Colt commercial is about an old man sitting in the nursing home. You ever seen that commercial? And the aide comes by with a cart of Coke. And she gives this old man who's sitting there, and he looks like he's just one step away from the grave. And he takes a drink of that Coke, and his eyes pop wide open. The next thing he's doing, he's riding a motorcycle. The next thing he's done, he's called his sweetheart. And the next thing he's done, he's jumping out of an airplane. And the next thing he's doing, he's over in Italy on the bull run with a bull right on him. He's running for everything he's worth. I love that commercial. I mean, he found life when he drank that Coke. Now, here's the interesting thing of my story. We're not told that. I think the guy's name, let me tell you the guy's name. I do have it in my notes. The guy's name was Robert Woodruff. Robert Woodruff was the CEO of Coke from 1923 to 1955. Okay? And here's what he said. He said, every person in the world ought to taste Coke one time. That was his slogan. And he worked and he worked and he worked. And then they came up with that commercial saying, if you drink Coke, it gives life. Now, this man almost accomplished that. And here we are in 2015. The church is 2,000 years old and we've got living water and we're not doing anything about it, guys. Can you imagine that? We've got living water. Man, it says you can come to these waters and you can drink of those waters and life comes, health comes, strength comes, forgiveness comes, power comes, love comes, grace comes, kindness comes, mercy comes. Wow. Can you imagine that? We've got the answer, guys. His name is Jesus. He loved me so much he died on a cross. But it didn't end there. God raised him from the dead. And guess what? He's alive today, guys. Amen. Man, we've got the living water. We need to catch the vision. And say, man, everybody needs to have a drink of this water. Amen. Everybody needs to drink of this water. Because it is life transforming. It is life changing. Oh, man. Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation to those who believe. You know that word salvation there? It means to be saved. It means to be set free. It means to be healed. It means to be delivered. And so Paul says, man, I'm not ashamed of this message. I'm going to share that message. I'm going to declare that message. You know what I love? I got 2,000 pennies right before I left to go to New Orleans. And it's amazing on these pennies. We were in a busy restaurant. And this waitress, she was working her socks off. And, of course, down there, every restaurant is busy during New Orleans or the Mardi Gras. People stand in line. And I told this girl, I said, I got something for you. And she's, what do you mean? I said, I've got a little something I want to give you. And I pulled a penny out and I held this penny up. She looked at that penny and she, wow, I never seen anything like that. And you know, I shared that penny and I told her, I said, if you look on the back of it, the bottom of the penny, it says 1 cent. And I just wanted to tell you that God loved you so much, he sent his only son to show his love to you. Her eyes got great big. And I seen her, and she had a necklace on. She reached up and tucked that necklace off, and she said, here, give me that penny. And she threaded that penny through that necklace. She said, I'll never take it off. I'll wear it because I need to know that God loves me. You know what was neat? In that busy restaurant, she went and told another waitress. And they come, they said, can we have a penny? I went to pay for my bill, and a guy stepped up there out of the line because they had assembly line where they were cooking. He said, can I have a penny? And I thought, wow, just over a little penny, just over a short little message that it's the one sent from heaven, God shut a busy restaurant down just for a few minutes, that people in there could have a penny to know that God loves them. Isn't that neat, guys? You know, and it's that simple, I believe. If we'll allow God to empower us, enable us, equip us, and we step out for him, that we begin to represent him and that we begin to see his glory move through our lives. Can I hear an amen out of that? Now listen, this is my last thing. I want to share with you in this. Galatians 5, 6. And I want you to listen to Galatians 5, 6. This is the latter part of it. It says, "For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything, but faith," and look at it, Larry's got it up there, "but faith working through love." And here's what I want you to understand. We need to fall in love with Him. We need to allow the Word of God to stir a faith in us, that we'll step out in faith and love. And it's amazing, over and over in the Scriptures, that compassion compelled Jesus. Love compelled Him to go the extra mile. Love compelled Him to step out and touch a person's life. Even the story we know so well in Sunday school, we call it the Good Samaritan. And actually, it was just said a certain Samaritan. But when the man come along and saw the wounded stranger, it said compassion. Love motivated him to reach out and touch that man's life. You see, the church in the year 2015, we need to say, "God, fill us with your love. Fill us with your power. Stir in our hearts a compassion for people." I don't know about you guys, and I know you may never have a chance to go down to New Orleans on a mission trip, and maybe you will. But I walked through the streets of the French Quarters, and sometimes I just wanted to stop and cry. Sometimes I just wanted to weep because I saw hurting people. I saw people doing dumb things. I saw people that was so spaced out, they didn't know where they were at. And my heart broke. And then I thought, wow, I wonder how God feels. I wonder how God feels. And then I'd look and I'd see one of our guys, and they'd be kneeling down by one of the people, and they'd be praying for them. They'd be sharing the love of Jesus. And I thought, wow, you're so good, God. No matter how hard the devil tried to shut things down, God's grace was always more sufficient. Don't you think we need to ask God to give us eyes? You know, the other scripture, Jesus dealing with the disciples, and he said, "Open your eyes and look, for the harvest is there." Can you imagine it? He said, "Open your eyes, not your physical eyes, but your spiritual eyes," because he said, "The harvest is there. The harvest is there. It's there. It's all around us. It's our next door neighbor. It's our friend." I got the call this week that our friend Dorothy said she was very serious. Got the call that Mary McCroy had passed away. And then I got a call from my friend Mark Mathis. And he said, "Gerald, you told me if I needed to talk to you, you was available. Are you available?" I thought, man, I just got back from New Orleans. I was going to go with Carolyn. He said, "You told me you'd talk." And so I went and met with him, spent 5 hours with him. And Carolyn told me, she said, "Make sure you give Mark a penny before you leave him." And so I began to share with him, and I said, "Mark, I want to give you this penny. I know it's been tough." And he said, "Man," he said, "I need that." He said, "You gave me a rock." And he said, "I carried that rock," and he said, "all my difficult times," he said, "I reach in that pocket." He said, "that old rock would be there And he said, you always told me that he was my rock. All other ground could be sinking sand, but you told me I could stand. And he said, I lost my rock. And he said, now you're giving me a penny. Guys, there's people out there hurting. There's people who need help. But it's got to start right here. It's got to start right here in our hearts. Amen? Let's stand together. You know, the thing about Calvary, there's always room at the foot of the cross. There's always room. Though thousands have come, there's still room for one. Amen? Isn't that, I know that's a part of that old hymn, but it's true. There's always room at the cross. If you're here and you've got some excess baggage, if you've got things that have weighed you down, and you're not running the race, really simple. You can give him the baggage. And you know, I discovered something this week, guys. How many of you believe he's the same yesterday, today, and forever? Isn't that pretty neat? I always use that to talk about miracles we're here and all this. But God really spoke to my heart. And, you know, Peter denied him. Peter even cursed in denying him. But God never changed. He still loved Peter just as much as he did before. Aren't you glad of that? He still loves you just as much. Even though you may be weighed down with baggage, he still loves you. And if you'll come, he'll take the baggage. Can't beat that deal. He'll take it all away. And he said, man, I'll love you just as much. Never stopped. Never will. And I'll always care. So if you need to come by the cross, simple. If you looked at your life and you lack the power, Pentecost is still there. Power is still there. He says it's rivers of living water that will never run dry. So we're going to sing. What are we going to sing, Monty? If you need prayer, you come. If you just need to come and say, God, I just want to soak up with you, you come. good, isn't he? Amen? Aren't you glad he loves you? Won't you kind of scoot together in the center and join hands? Isn't God good? Amen. All the time, isn't he? Wow. Have you enjoyed Monty here today? Amen. Amen. Just give him a good hand clap. I appreciate him being here. Thank you, Monty. Thank you, Monty. You know, as we go through this thing, God really began to speak to my heart about our church here. And I'm pretty excited about what God's showing. Amen. Pretty excited about what God, I believe, is getting ready to put together. You know, an interesting thing, it's this a little food for thought I'll leave with you. You know, Fred Bishop's son, Shane, pastors Christ Church in Fairview Heights. And it's one of the largest Methodist churches now, I guess, in Illinois. And he runs 2,100 people on Sunday morning. And it went from a little over 100 people to 2,100 people. They have three or four satellite churches that run 200 or 300 people. So we're talking maybe on a Sunday morning, they may minister to 3,000 people. Pretty heavy, isn't it? And that God could do that. And but anyway, what God spoke to my heart, here we are in Ava, Illinois. We don't even have 2,100 people. we could bring Camel Hill, and I don't think we could hit, maybe 1,000. I don't know. I don't know what the tendency is. It don't make any difference. Here's what God spoke to me. And something I want you to begin to pray about. I believe that God wants this church, to be a feeder church to a lot of little areas. And one of the things, the move is, a lot of the big churches are going to satellites, because they can't build and afford to build all the buildings to house all the people, okay? Well, in Southern Illinois, we've got a little churches closing down because they can't afford to maintain their buildings. So one of the things that God spoke to my heart is that we become a feeder church, and we can do what the big churches are doing, only we do it in reverse to save lives. And that we can reach out and feed some of the other little communities and link us all together. Wouldn't that be kind of exciting if we had we were linked electronically to a little community that couldn't hardly exist, but they were worshiping with us by electronics and whatever. Larry knows how to do all of that. wouldn't that be pretty neat? Huh? And you know, it's kind of interesting. I've got all these different people I deal with, and they're scattered all over. And one of the struggling things is they can't exist. They can't afford a pastor. They can't all do it. And so God spoke to my heart, and he said, build a feeder church, link it together electronically, just like they're doing in the big churches because they can't build buildings, but to save churches. Does that kind of ring a bell with you? Huh? Doesn't that kind of get exciting to you? That we could set that up, and we could have a powerful worship service here that was feeding these other little communities, linking us all together, and then through the week, men of God that feel and women that got a call on our life, we send them in to minister to the people. I think that's a way to let the light shine here in Southern Illinois. And man, God dropped that in my spirit, and that's just to whet your appetite, okay? You know, and there's no telling what God wants to do here, guys. And you know, this may be my last rodeo, so. I want to write it for everything it's worth. So let's pray together. And let's trust God. Let God speak to your heart. You know? And man, I tell you what, David Jones, I'm so glad you're back here. Matter of fact, I hadn't seen you cleaned up, and I thought, man, I've got some dignified man. I thought, wow, this is some dignified man in here. David's our plumber, guys, that done all the plumbing. Guys, I think you ought to give him a hand, too. Amen. Appreciate you, Dave. And that's his lovely wife, Kim. Amen. Let's join together in prayer. Father, thank you for your love. Thank you that it never ends. And I pray, Father God, that you'll speak to our hearts. Father, I pray that you'll enlarge our visions. And I pray, Father God, that you'll strengthen us with your Holy Spirit, that you'll fill us with love, that it'll overflow out of our lives and touch the people around us. And Father, I pray that you'll move in our church family and cause us to be a light, not only to Ava, but the surrounding areas, Father. And we thank you for all that you do. Go with us, and we commit our lives to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hug somebody around you. Tell them you love them in Jesus.